DepthMapML inside of Silhouette uses AI to analyze an image and determine how far away the different objects are within that image. We can use the resultant depth map to do a myriad of other tasks, including working with other depth objects in the depth node, or we can use it to control color correction, blurs, or lighting effects, creating maps according to different levels of depth. My name is Ben Brownlee for Boris FX, and I'm going to give you a quick start to DepthMapML and then take it deeper, showing you how you can manipulate this map and create your own custom compound nodes. Here is our first shot. We have our character in the middle of a room holding some form of object here. And first thing I'm going to do is just apply the DepthMapML. And I'll play this back. And we can see that DepthMapML has automatically generated an image about what it determines to be the foreground and background objects within our scene. Let's pause the playback around about here. And we can take a look in the bottom left-hand corner and see a depth preview, which is like an exaggerated version of the depth within the scene. That's looking pretty good. Now, is the result perfect? No, but it's a good starting point. If we have a look at the node parameters, you can see I have different models to work with. Some are faster to process out, and some take a little bit more time, but are going to give a more detailed result. In terms of outputting, we can take this to RGBA or straight alpha only. And if I come up to depth, I can switch between those different views. I'm going to play this through one more time. And you can see there is some strobing happening within the image. And it points the baton, whatever this object happens to be, sort of disappears out of view. And kind of, well, if we look at the depth preview here in a bit more detail, you can see that sort of sucks its way into the body rather than sticks out, which is what it should do. And there's a few things we can do here. Some of these are easier to solve than others, but it always starts with mapping. So mapping has different options as well. We have scale and we have points. If we go to scale, then these controls are the most important. So scale itself is giving, it's almost like a gain or brightness increase or decrease. And we can see if we look at the depth preview again, if I take my scale down, everything starts to flatten. And as I move my scale up, we start to get a more exaggerated result, losing any sort of subtleties that we had in the character depth map there. And obviously, depending on what your overall goal is with this, having a perfectly detailed depth map like this may actually not be what you're after. I'm going to jump over to another version of this session where I've already got the points mapped out. So when we have our mapping set to points, we now have a near depth point, which I'll bring over here, and we have a far depth point as well. So these are physical points that are setting what is going to be counted as the closest and the furthest part. And these can be keyframed, as I've already done here. So we play that through. We can see the near depth and the far depth points are traveling along with the hand. So this can be a great way of avoiding overall sort of scene jitter, especially if we have objects that are moving in and out from the sides of the screen or the top and bottom of the screen as well. What it doesn't do though, is if we have areas of confusion, again, with this baton here, where it's not sure what the relationship is on the baton at certain frames, that's not going to change that fact, but it does get the rest of our result a lot more manageable. So if I jump over to the other branch, and I can also create trackers here. So I have a tracker on the hand and one on the background. I can connect these trackers to my far depth and near depth, and obviously make any changes that I need to. And if I play that through, you can see the tracking data is driving most of that movement. I can add in additional adjustments if I need to with keyframes, but most of the work is being done for me with the tracking. Well, let's take a look at our second shot. I've already applied the depth map to it. So here's the original. We'll take a little look at the depth preview. These are just running at the default settings. So I've wanted to bring this in as a part of a bigger depth workflow. I'll add a depth node on another branch, and I'll pipe in the depth map data into my alpha input one. And remember, with the depth map node, we're taking out RGBA. And I can just come in the depth and add in an alpha layer. And that will take in the data directly from our depth map. But of course, if I wanted to add in any other object in here, we can do that too. And for other information about the depth node, check out our other tutorials linked in the description below. If instead of wanting to use this depth map data though, as part of a depth map, and maybe want to help drive other effects, here's a quick way of doing that. So I'm going to take out the output to alpha only. And I'll just come in and add a color correct. I'll push everything blue. And I'll take another copy of the depth map into the obey mat input. Come to obey mat in color correct and click on obey. And invert. And because of the detail that we have in the depth map, we're getting this sort of nice fall off happening. So it's not the same as just using a regular mat. And if I play this through, because it's being calculated for us automatically, we maintain that sort of fall off all the way through. We haven't had to do any kind of actual, you know, work. So this is cool if we just want to use the depth map as it is straight out of depth map ML. But what if we want to use that depth in a different way? If we want to manipulate it or just take individual ranges of this depth? Let's take a look. Get rid of color correct, and I'm going to change my output back to RGBA. We'll see why in just a second. And I'll come to my key category, and I'm going to add in zMatte. Boom. And I'll change this to primary matte. And zMatte is like our big overall key. Well, we could do things like blue screen, green screen keys, or if I go to extract on, we can come in and, you know, do channel keys based off of luminance, hue, saturation, RGB, cyan, magenta, yellow. But, you know, obviously we just want luminance here because luminance is the interesting bit. And it's these controls that are going to be the most important for us. I'll ignore position and range for a second. You'll see why. So we have blacklit, where we can determine where our background plane is going to be, our far plane is going to be. We have white clip, where we can determine where our near plane is going to be. The interesting ones actually are position and range. With the default values, position is set to 100. The near values are going to be set to white. If I set this to 0, the far values are going to be set to white. So they're going to be the ones that are going to be affected. And check out what happens when I change the range up. So with the range set to 100, we have like a very wide key. We have a very wide range. As I bring this down, we can see that those levels, that range that we're looking at is getting smaller and smaller. So if I set this range to 50, with the position set to 100, we're really only looking at like the absolute black values and anything in the sort of 50% middle gray. Now here's the interesting bit. If I change position at this point, we change the focus of where the white values actually are. And I'm going to take my range down to a smaller slice, something like 15. And just take a look at this now. As I move the position through, we're getting a very limited slice based off of the depth. Kind of fun, yeah? So let's feed this into a color correct. I won't do anything too clever with this. All I'm going to do is just boost the brightness up, boost the saturation up maybe. There we go. That's it. Now I'm going to take my zMatte output into the obey mat over here and do what we did previously, turn on obey. And now we're only getting that color correction happening on the slice that we're creating inside of zMatte. So as I move my position around here, you can see we're getting just that light beam happening on a particular depth, based off a particular depth. Come back in here, maybe I'll make this a bit easier to see. Really warm this up. overly warm, but that's fine. And now, because all of this is being generated procedurally by the depth map, we really don't have to do any work at all. So we've done this once, but what if we want to do this time and time again? Now let's see what happens if I just select the depth map and zMatte, right click on these and go create compound node. Ooh la la. What this has done now is it's taken those two individual nodes and put them together as one. If I double click on the compound node here, we can go in and we can change things up. Maybe I want to bulletproof this a little bit more. So maybe instead of just taking out this slice as a separate channel, I want to copy the alpha channel to all the other channels. Let's come over and just add in a swap channels and select that to alpha, alpha, alpha. Now the luma and the alpha are going to be exactly the same. So if I expand my node parameters out a little bit, if I want to clean this up a bit more, for example, I don't need people to see swap channels. I can just click on the three dots, go hide node, or any of the other controls I want to do. I can just click on the three dots, turn off published on any of these. And I have my own compound node that I can come in and publish as a real node. So if I come into my third shot, I've already got a depth slicer here, which is one I've built earlier, and it's just made up of depth map and the zMatte. Let's turn the blur down, turn the range up, and the position there. And you can see I've hidden all of the other controls that I don't need. And we've got inputs for the image and also for the tracking data. So we could, you know, use tracking data as we did in the first example. And one of the things I really like about DepthMapML is being able to use it to drive these types of effects very, very quickly, just as you would do any other sort of procedural effect. If you've got any more questions, then of course, leave them in the comments below. If you want to try this for yourself, head over to borisfx.com and you can either get yourself a free trial, or if you have an active subscription or upgrade, then just download the latest copy of Silhouette. My name is Ben Brownlee for Boris FX. See you again soon.